great to be with you. We've got a fabulous show lined up for you today. June is World Infertility, World Infertility Awareness Month. And so we're going to be shining the light on all things infertility. I have Dr. Lawrence Gobetz on the show. He's a medical director at the Vitalab Fertility Clinic in Sandton. And we're going to be looking at all these topics around infertility. And then a little bit later, I'm going to have Johan Hari on the show. He's a best-selling author. We've had him on the show before we spoke about lost connections. He's just written Magic Pill, and I think you're going to be interested in this one. Everyone's talking about Ozempic, this amazing weight loss drug. And he's written an entire book. This is a journalist. He leaves no stone unturned with amazing stories and personal insights. So that'll be coming up at about 12:30. So that's what you have to look forward to here on the DL Link show. But let's get started. We want to look how to navigate really successfully all fertility options despite chronic illness. Dr. Gobetz, welcome and thank you so much for joining us.
Hi, Nikki. Great to be with you. Hi to the listeners. And willing to answer whatever questions you have. Let's give it a go.
Fabulous, fabulous. Well, I love, you know, how we have different months representing different things because it's bringing in awareness. And we always like to do that for our listeners. So as I said, June is World Infertility Awareness Month. So perhaps you can tell us more about the importance of this awareness month and the global challenges of infertility that it aims to address.
Yeah, it's a very topical issue today for many reasons. One, we know that the sizes of families are decreasing. In other words, we no longer, especially in first world environments, are having 5-6 children. It's more to one or maybe two children. At the end of the day, couples are first completing their careers and then establishing themselves in the financial arena and then only settling down and saying, right now, we're ready to have a baby. And the biggest issue that we don't appreciate is that males keep making sperm until the day you bury us. Or as I always say to patients, maybe you want to bring us home in a glass vase and put us on the mantelpiece. And ovaries are very different because a woman is, as a female fetus, gets her total basket of eggs in her mother's womb at 20 weeks and loses about 5 million between 20 weeks and birth, and then carries on to lose eggs every month thereafter until they eventually go into the menopause. So women don't make new eggs, and as they get older, the eggs age with them and the eggs become less productive. They are genetically older, they don't work as well. And as a woman gets over the age of 35, so her natural potential starts to decrease completely. And that is why there's this whole move towards trying to make females aware of the fact that they're going to take a while to find Mr. Right, they're going to get themselves established. So today they should be aware that they can put their fertility on hold. They can put their eggs in the freezer. But they mustn't come at 39 and want to put eggs in the freezer. So the other thing that they don't appreciate is the fact that in order for you to have a baby, and if we are going to preserve your female fertility, and this goes as well for preserving fertility in patients who have cancer, who are now going to have chemotherapy that may wipe out their ovarian function or wipe out their sperm function. So the younger we can put your eggs in the freezer, the better the outcome, number one. Number two, one egg in the freezer does not equal one baby. And as you get older, you almost need the number of eggs in the freezer equivalent to the female age. So if you want to have two babies and you're 35, we need 35 eggs in the freezer. Because not every egg fertilizes, not every fertilized egg becomes a normal embryo. So at the end of the day, you know, women who are looking at freezing their eggs mustn't just go and put 8 eggs in the freezer and think, oh, well, out of this, they're going to have their whole family. So infertility awareness is, it's there in the background. We know that roughly about 86% of couples setting out to form a family unit will conceive in 6 months. And that's 86% in 6 months, but only 4% in the next 6 months. So Bharat, for everybody, if you've tried for 6 months and you haven't got there, you know, you should start thinking about getting to a fertility specialist. And the other thing about awareness is you will go as a patient to your gynecologist, and you will start out with a gynecologist, and the gynecologist will feel obliged to start some basic treatment, like giving the patient Clomid or letrozole to induce ovulation. And then at the end of the day, nothing's happening. And then eventually the gynecologist will say, okay, now you need to go to a fertility specialist. In fact, I like to encourage these young patients to get to a fertility specialist first, because your gynecologist's responsibility is different. They're there to look after you from the female well-being point of view, but they aren't trained in infertility. And unfortunately, when you do get older as a female, you do not want to waste time. So I always say, put your hand up, go and see a fertility clinic. It does not mean the fertility clinic is going to do IVF on you. It needs to be indicated. So at the end of the day, we need more and more awareness. Young girls think that when they get to 40, they'll find Mr. Right and they'll fall pregnant at the drop of a hat. And those are the exceptions, not the rule. So, you know, be aware of the fact that your ovary is very different to a testicle. Your eggs get older with you. You lose eggs every month. More than 1,000 eggs every month are just disappearing. And that's why women ultimately go into the menopause. So having a month where we are every day of the month imposing upon people to be aware, to know what they should do, when they should seek help, etc., is of vital importance.
Thanks so much, Dr. Gobetz. Okay, so let's unpack that, because as you said, the awareness is so important. So first port of call, you spoke about women freezing their eggs. So even before, as you say, they go into a relationship or they married, or, you know, they're having difficulty falling pregnant. So we will move to that just now. But we're looking at young girls. They haven't maybe found their partner, their ideal partner yet. And at what point do you think they should start to consider freezing their eggs? As you say, they shouldn't all of a sudden at the age of 35 go, oh. So when do you think, what would you suggest?
So preferably not too early. So in other words, not from 18. Okay. So because we do find in our younger females, the eggs don't tend to be as good as when they get a little older. So we start.
Oh, interesting.
23, and we have that experience with our donors. So we have a donor egg bank here, and the younger the donors, okay, the less functional the eggs are. So we want those donors to be at least 22, 23 or older. Now, one way for patients to look at this is just go to Google, go to images, and get an image on female age and fertility, and look at that graph and see how that graph drops off. So we would like to encourage females from 32 and under to come in and freeze their eggs. But when you start to get to 35, and unfortunately, most of the patients coming to us to freeze eggs are in the 35 to 40 age group, which is strictly speaking a bit late, because this is still a unique concept. It's not a concept that rings home, you know. And you, when you are 30 or 31 or 32, you still feel like you've got another ahead of you for fertility, which you don't have. And the other thing that the females don't think is the fact that, okay, so I'll have my first baby at 38, but now what about a sibling? Because when they get to 40 or 41 for the sibling, it's too late. So freezing eggs does not necessarily mean you need to use them. Because when Mr. Right does come along, you're going to try on your own. So those eggs in the freezer are your security, your insurance. But it's very important to know that it doesn't mean because you've frozen eggs that when you do meet Mr. Right, you're not going to try there and then with your own eggs. You will, provided you're not 49 and you've now met Mr. Right. Then you go and use your 32-year-old frozen eggs, because you're going to have a much better chance. So we know that we need something to say, let's put female potential on hold. And we have no drugs and we have no diet and nothing else, no Ozempic, nothing, to make those eggs stay young. And the only way that we can make the eggs stay young is to put them in the freezer, because then we put that biology on hold. So until we can work out some kind of recipe that stops the aging process in the ovaries, there's only one way to do it, and that's put your eggs in the freezer. And the younger you are, preferably somewhere between, I would say, 23 and up to 32 is the best time to get your eggs in the freezer. When you start to push to 35, I always say to have 15 eggs in the freezer at 35 is better than having no eggs. So don't let your age put you off it. Go and discuss it with the fertility specialist so that you can get the right perspective. Now, the important thing about that too is that, Nikki, women are given two ages. You have a chronological age and you have a genetic age. And that genetic programming is done at the time when your father's sperm fertilizes your mother's egg. So some women are programmed to lose their eggs much quicker. So we do see young women today that have got a very limited egg supply. So if we are going to freeze for them, it's going to depend on the egg store as to how many eggs we will be able to get out of them out of one stimulation to put in the freezer. And in these younger girls with a limited store, they may need to do two or three stimulations to build up their egg store number. So we may need to do egg accumulation. Versus there's another female of the same age who's going to give us 30 eggs in one stimulation. She's got all her eggs in the freezer. So one's got to go and get an assessment of your own potential. And that's something that by right, your normal gynecologist should be able to evaluate a female. We scan the ovaries. We can count the little egg sacs on ultrasound. And the number of egg sacs that we see in the ovary gives us an understanding of how many eggs we will be able to get out of that ovary if we stimulate that patient for egg freezing. So we can already give that patient an understanding of her egg count. So a woman has quantity, and quantity is dependent on what we see on ultrasound. And they also have quality, and the quality is in the female age. So if we've got a young woman with a low egg reserve or a low egg quantity, she's still got a good chance because you don't need many eggs to help her have a baby. But if you've got an older woman, you need a lot more eggs because less of the eggs are going to be genetically competent. And the problem is the older you get, the lower your egg store. So try and get in there before 32 years old.
So, wow, fascinating. So what is involved in extracting those eggs? And when we talk about freezing them, perhaps you can answer this in the second part. How is it done and how long can you freeze those eggs for? So first of all, how is it done? Is it painful? Is it difficult? Is it a big, costly, experience?
So firstly, a woman every cycle is probably generating and there's eggs getting into a race or somewhere in the region of 100 to 1,000 eggs. And the brain controls that race by ensuring that only one egg runs ahead and wins the race because the womb is made for a singleton. So every month, a woman is losing those 1,000 eggs in the background for the one to win the race. Now, we can control that, and we learned that if we manufacture the same hormone that the brain gives off to tell the ovary to only recruit one egg, we can rescue eggs that the female is going to lose. And how many eggs we can rescue is related to that egg count that I described previously on ultrasound. So if I scan and I see 8 in the one ovary and 8 in the other side, I know I will, over a period of 10 days of injections, I will be able to rescue 16 eggs, roughly, or 18 eggs out of that cycle of stimulation over a period of 10 days or 11 days. Once we've scanned and we're happy with the size of the egg sacs, we give a final maturation injection, and then 36 hours later, the patient goes into our IVF suite and we give her conscious sedation, and there's a professional sedationist that does the conscious sedation, and we recover the eggs transvaginally. So we have a special needle guide, and through the vagina, we safely go through the wall into the ovary and we aspirate the eggs. It takes on average about 10 minutes to get those eggs out. Once we've finished, we then move the patient onto a bed. We take her back to the ward. She recovers from a conscious sedation. Her poor mind has been knocked now from, so it's a short-term memory, can't remember anything. And when she asks you 100 times how many eggs did she get, so we put a nice little smiley sticker on the back of their hand and we write the number on so they don't have to end up asking 100 people how many eggs they got, including the poor man that's servicing the air conditioner. So how many eggs. It takes them maybe a half an hour to an hour for them to be wide awake. And then we always insist that somebody takes them home. They cannot go home in an Uber after conscious sedation. The reaction time is not good, and they don't want to be in an accident after conscious sedation because the insurance company will not cover them. So the process is quite simple. In the old days, we used to have a very high risk of a condition called ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome, which is related to how many eggs they respond to and how we actually finally mature the eggs. Fortunately, today, we do not have that anymore, but unfortunately, there are people still, and even in South Africa, where patients are being treated and they do develop the ovarian hyperstimulation. It can be quite dangerous. You can die from it. You can spend a week in ICU from it. But one thing I can promise you, in our unit, you have zero risk of ovarian hyperstimulation. And it's very important because that's the most important risk. When you are recovering eggs, there is always a small risk. You know, you're putting a needle through the vagina into the ovaries. They may bleed afterwards. You can sometimes get infection. But the incidence of those complications are less than 1%. They're very low in competent hands. Now, once we've got those eggs out, not all the eggs will be ripe. And we expect the ripeness to be roughly 80%. So if we've got 20 eggs out, we may only be able to freeze 16, because you can't freeze immature eggs. You need to freeze mature eggs that are ready to be fertilized. Once the eggs are out, we let them, they remain in the lab for about 3 hours, and then we put them through a very quick process. Today, we do what we call vitrification, which is a rapid freeze technology. In the old days, we did slow vitrification, and the poor embryologist had to sit here for 4 to 6 hours to freeze one batch of eggs. Now they can freeze eggs within less than 10 minutes. And we put those eggs through a process, three different solutions that help to, number one, get the water out of the egg, and number two, to put it's almost like an antifreeze into the egg to protect the cells, and then we drop that into liquid nitrogen. Now, liquid nitrogen is a fluid that has a temperature of minus 197 degrees. We have our own liquid nitrogen cupboard here in our parking lot, which manufactures our own liquid nitrogen, so we don't have to worry about truck strikes and Afrox not being able to get it to us. And it's not electricity, because patients often say, what do you do with my embryos when there's a power out? So the embryos are in liquid nitrogen. There's no electricity. And as long as you look after the level of your liquid nitrogen in the canister or dewar that contains the embryos, you now have the egg that comes along. You stop its biology. It remains like that until you warm it. And when we warm it, we do it in roughly the same amount of time, and we reverse the process of the three different fluids, and then your egg is wide awake and ready to go. So all you've done is just stop the biology. You haven't aged the egg, and today our survival rates post-freezing on our eggs is very high. It's about 98%, so we hardly ever lose eggs when we warm them. And then their potential is exactly the same as what their potential would have been had we frozen them right there and then at when they were 25. So now they're 40 using 25-year-old eggs with a far better potential to give them good embryos. So freezing, there is no, it's not like Woolworths, as I say, there's no use by date or sell by date. And we have no law in our country, like certain countries have a law that if you don't use the eggs within a specific period of time, the lab is by law have to destroy the eggs. And it's the same with frozen embryos. We have no duration in our country legally that you have to then destroy the embryos. So those eggs can stay in there. You can perhaps even put them in your family trust and give them to your great-great-grandchildren. Wow. So currently, no law controls how long those eggs can remain frozen for. They do not age in the liquid nitrogen. It's just the biology that stops and warm them, and the biology continues.
Absolutely fascinating. Technology amazes me. And as you say, when you compare it to what it used to be and what it is now, it's just fascinating. And as you were explaining what the woman has to go through, I was thinking about men who decide to freeze their sperm and how much more pleasurable their experience is compared to a woman's experience. It's so unfair.
I have to come in there, because when we freeze sperm, we do encourage the males to produce the sperm on site. Because when you give a sperm sample, you have the C, which is the fluid, and then you have the fish in the sea. Now, we want to get that fish out of that sea within 20 minutes, because the longer you leave the fish in the sea, the more that sea impacts negatively on the fish. So when we ask them to produce it here, we always have these weird requests, and we have these comments that the room that we put them in is, you know, it's only a one star, and they want this and they want that, and they don't want to hear the floor outside, and that puts them off. So we have a lot of issues, and we have to think in terms of what does the room look like that we now send them in to produce the specimen. So we have issues with them as well, and sometimes it is stressful for a male, and sometimes they cannot perform on demand, and we have to then take that into consideration and say to them, don't panic. If it happens, we just rebook it. So although one says, listen, it is more for the female, the males also have their own set of problems. Yeah. So, but at the end of the day, yes, it's far easier, and there's no procedure that you have to go through, and there's no conscious sedation. So yes, I agree, it is easier.
But exactly. Everything has the complications and the difficulties, Dr. Gobetz. So let's look in terms of cancer. You mentioned ovarian cancer. For cancer patients who are going for chemotherapy and radiotherapy and all sorts of treatments, would you say that all people should depending on the age, of course, should go and freeze their eggs or freeze their sperm? Would you recommend that?
So we are part, our unit is part of the oncology consortium, which Fertility Preservation, Oncology Fertility Consortium, which is an international program. And we introduced it a few years ago, and one of my partners, Dr. Chris Fenter, that's his hobby horse. So Chris sees most of our oncology patients, and some of the other partners will stand in for him if he's not here. So it's taken us a while, and we've got to a stage now where we have got friends with the oncologists. And if the female or the male is in a reproductive age group, they send them here immediately. So we have a 24/7 line. We will see the patient immediately. The diagnosis is there to give them counseling on fertility preservation. So we are ready, and we can freeze from eggs to sperm to ovarian tissue in prepubertal females, to ovarian tissue in postpubertal females, to even pediatric testicular tissue. So we are running a separate oncology fertility section on our unit that looks after these patients. And I say, we have a hotline. Anybody wants it, you can get it off our website at www.vitalab.com. And we are there for you 24/7, even on weekends for this, because it's for us, it's an emergency. And once we have counseled the patient, they may choose to say, well, you know what, it's more important for me to get my chemo tomorrow, and I'll worry about if I do find the right man, I'll use egg donation later on. But at least they've been counseled, and they have the opportunity to make that informed decision. And we know now what's important today is when you have a diagnosis of cancer, it's not something that just reared its head in 24 hours. It's something that's been around for quite a few months. So another 2 or 3 weeks just to put your eggs or sperm or ovarian tissue or testicular tissue in the freezer is not going to impact negatively on your cancer outcome. And once you've preserved your fertility, because most of the drugs we use are, unfortunately, they knock out rapidly developing cells, which are your sperm and your eggs. So a lot of chemotherapy is going to either cause the no sperm present after the chemo or no eggs present. And those couples have to then consider donor eggs or donor sperm. So just for people out there to know, we're there for them. It's become a different universe now, and the oncologist.
Hey.
So, yeah, it's all good from that point of view.
Thank you, Dr. Gobetz. I have to ask you one more question before you do go. So if you've got all these people who are freezing their eggs, freezing their sperm, they then get into a relationship, they go on to have kids, they don't even have to, as you say, some of them don't have to use their eggs and their sperm later on. What do you do if they never return? I mean, how long do you have them on hold for? And I mean, what happens to, you know, the sperm down the line in 15? 3 years' time, seeing as though there's no legislation to have to get rid of them within a certain period of time.
But Nikki, they have an annual renewal cost for the freezing.
Aha. Uh-huh.
We do remain in contact with them. Those people that we have lost contact with, and we have done every reasonable attempt at trying to get hold of them to make a decision, we are then legally obliged to discard the sperm or the eggs. Unless the couple say to us, no, we don't want you to discard it yet, and then continue to pay for the annual renewable storage fee. So we do remain in contact. We can discard them. If a couple decide to do away with them, we can, on their permission, they sign a consent form that gives us that permission. So we do take care of that. We have very few people that we lose to follow up.
I hear you. Dr. Gobetz, thank you so much. Thank you for explaining it so clearly. And I think so important to have this awareness, as we say, with June World Infertility Awareness Month, and really giving men and women something to think about, specifically women, as you pointed out, looking at freezing those eggs. So if you could just share your website address just one more time before we say goodbye.
Okay, so we are at www.vitalab.com, not .co.za, .com. And Vitalab spelled V-I-T-A-L-A-B. And Nikki, thanks for the privilege. It's always great talking with you. And all the best to the listeners. And we do have they can email us directly via our website if they want any further questions. And we're there.
Fantastic. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks again for joining us. Go well. Look forward to chatting again soon. Dr. Lawrence Gobetz, Medical Director at Vitalab Fertility Clinic, Sandton. Such an interesting conversation. I certainly learnt a lot.